So James, you're a former heavy metal rock star. You once toured the world playing guitar in a metal rock band, and now you're what you call a CX rock star. Can you tell us real quick, what is James Dodkins all about, and what's the CX philosophy you stand for?
Well, the thing is, what I try and do in the customer experience world is to take quite complex ideas and sort of put them together in nice little packages for people and deliver it in entertaining ways, ways that make people laugh, ways that make people think, and ways that are kind of unforgettable. So my philosophy is all around unforgettability. Is that a word? Oh, it is now. Oh. And simplicity. And the thing is, I get called a thought leader quite a lot, which is very nice. But most of the time, I'm just a thought reminder, just reminding people of some simple things that we can do every day to make our customer experience rock.
Okay. And what exactly is a customer experience that rocks?
Well, it's a good question. The thing is, there's kind of six elements to a really, really good customer experience that I've noticed. Now, you don't necessarily need to excel on every single one of these, but you tend to find the best customer experiences in the world have these six elements. So they are fast, they are easy, they are convenient, which are all separate things. Some people will argue that, but they are separate things. They are trackable, they are personalized, and they are predictive. If you can get good on at least one of those things, you're doing well. But the aim is to try and nail all six of those or get as good as possible in each six areas.
And do you think it's common for businesses to nail all six of those?
Nope. No, not at all. It's very rare, in fact.
Yeah. And you do a lot of keynotes around the world, and you always open with a guitar performance. Why?
I do. Right, so because my talk is called Rules for Rockstars, and I lay out some rules that if you follow them, you will deliver a rockstar customer experience. The first rule is nail the intro. So it's about first impressions. And coming out playing guitar was the best way I could think of to practically demonstrate that rule about nailing the intro, about first impressions. Not coming out and going, "Hi guys. My name's James Dodkins," and I coming out playing guitar and everyone goes, "Whoa, okay, this guy means business. This is different. This is exciting." And it completely just changes the feel of an event.
Yeah. And when I watched some of your keynote excerpts, I got the sense that you're also trying to create a customer experience of your own for your audience.
Yes.
So the one that I saw that I thought was really funny was when you talked about how if your customers don't understand you, they're going to blame them, the business, not themselves. And you use the example of song lyrics, like people getting song lyrics wrong, and the type of disconnect that creates.
Yeah, it's completely true. Customers do misunderstand things quite a lot, and people shout at me, "We give them instruction manuals, Jay." All right, great, but customers don't always read them. And it's exactly like that with music fans. They don't always read the lyrics, and if you don't read the lyrics, it leaves the song open to misinterpretation. And that's what I do all the time.
Does anybody know what this is? It's a pterodactyl beaver. Now, you've probably not heard of that before, and I hadn't until Beyonce entered my life. And I'll now demonstrate to you why I thought a pterodactyl beaver was a thing, if this works.
The thing is, when I have found out that I've been singing the words wrong, I don't blame myself. I blame the artist. Just like when customers find out that they have misunderstood something about your products or services, they don't blame themselves. They blame you, the company.
So, James, can you talk me through the three core elements of CX? CX first impressions, you call them. You say impact, purpose, and direction. What are each of those things?
Well, the way I like to think about it is kind of like the intros to the best rock songs in the world. They have impact, purpose, and direction. So impact. Does your first impression leave a lasting impression? Will your customers talk about it in days, in weeks, in months? Will they tell their friends, their family? Will they talk about it on social media? Purpose. Does your first impression have designed within it the specifics around making your customers feel and think a particular way? Mine does. When I come out, I want the audience to feel intrigued and excited. Okay. But you have to ask yourself the question, does my first impression even have purpose? And direction, which is the final one. Does your first impression set the tone for the rest of the experience, or better yet, the rest of the relationship together? The problem is, most of the time, our first impressions as a company don't necessarily happen where and when we think they do. For a company, a first impression for a customer could come from an angry tweet or a review or a blog or a vlog. The thing is, one customer's bad experience can quickly become thousands of potential customers' bad first impression. So we need to sit down and work out, well, where do our first impressions actually happen? Then work to engineer in impact, purpose, and direction.
Some other rockstar metaphors or methods you use to impart CX wisdom through music?
I talk about superfans, how superfans will promote you for free. I talk about putting things right in the experience, which is something that when you're on stage, you have to do.
For sure. And actually, in one of your keynotes, you like to talk about a time when, you know, you were touring with your band, and you nearly ruined the final show of your band's first major tour, but then you somehow turned things around. Can you talk us through, like, what happened? How did you fix it? What can we learn from that?
I can. I will. I will tell you the story. So, we'd released our first album, and we were off on our first big headline UK tour, and I wanted to step up my stage game a little bit. So I thought, you know what, I'm going to learn how to spin my guitar. Now, if you don't know what that is, it's when you get your guitar and you throw it over your shoulder and the momentum brings it all the way back round and you catch it and carry on playing. Looks super cool. Trust me on that. Now, there is a trick to it. Would you like to know what the trick is?
Sure.
Good, because that's like the next bit of the story. The trick is you just got to really commit and throw it really hard and the momentum brings it back around. First night I'm there and I'm super nervous because I'm thinking, oh, what if I mess up? What if it doesn't come all the way around? But of course, adrenaline going, throw it really hard, flicks around, perfect. Everyone loves it. Really good. And I do this for the rest of the tour, all the way to the final date, which is our hometown gig, biggest gig of the entire tour. And I'm there getting to the end and I'm really excited for it by this point. I'm thinking, oh, they're going to love this. Spin. What had happened was I had practiced so much that I'd worn the leather on the strap, and instead of spinning the guitar, I just threw it really hard.
Oh,
remember,
goodness.
That part, really hard, into a wall. So I had two options. I was like, well, right, okay, what do I do? Do I run off stage crying, which was actually quite tempting, or do I fix the experience in the experience?
Yeah.
So literally in a split second, I ran forward and dived majestically into the crowd. Luckily, they caught me. And to this day, people still tell me that it is their favorite gig of ours that they ever went to. Now, as far as they were concerned, I became overwhelmed with heavy metal passion, threw my guitar and jumped in the crowd. But of course, we know what actually happened. But the whole point of this was I was empowered to do the thing that needed to be done to fix the experience in the experience. I didn't need to go and ask our manager to ring the record label to see if I had permission to jump into the crowd. Because I knew the successful outcome that needed to be delivered, I fixed the experience in the experience. And I think we should be thinking like this in our companies. Don't wait for the complaint. Fix the experience in the experience.
Yeah. So when in doubt, go crowd surfing.
Basically, yeah. That's yeah.
Okay. Interesting. So you wrote an article recently on LinkedIn comparing being a CX professional to being a sommelier. Can you
Yes.
talk through what you meant by that?
Yeah. So it's not really very rock star-y, but it's kind of true. These guys, they can distinguish so many different nuances within the wine. But the thing is as well, they won't just take what you say that you need. They will push a little bit further. They'll ask, you know, where is the meat from, where was what ranch was the cow grown on, or whatever. They'll ask all the questions
right.
to understand the meal that you're having, and only then will they suggest what wine. But they'll be able to suggest a Chateau Neuf de Pape or something. I heard that on telly. I don't even know what that is, but some fancy wine to go with it. Now, the thing is, the reason that's exactly like being a CX professional is there's lots of people out there where someone will say, ah, we're having loads of trouble with customer retention, and they'll go NPS, and that would just be their answer. They won't dig any deeper. They won't uncover the core elements to why there's an issue. The best customer experience professionals in the world will be able to uncover what the problem really is and then give a solution based on that. So I really think that we need to educate ourselves more on the sort of questions that we need to ask, the depth we need to go to understand situations, and also train ourselves to understand more distinctions in the solutions that we then provide.
So you have a new show called This Week in CX, and it's available on Amazon Prime UK. Congratulations.
Thank you.
So it's the number one rated and also the only CX show on Amazon. And I've seen some episodes. I thought they were hilarious. But can you explain for our viewers what the show is about?
The show is basically the events that have happened in the customer experience world in the week preceding, and then I make fun of them. That's basically it. So if you think of like the late night talk shows in America, so instead of making fun of Trump all the time, I do a little bit of that, but that's easy. I also make fun of companies that deliver awful customer experience or release crazy products. The thing is, look, realistically, you're not going to learn any really cool tools and techniques or any mind-changing methodologies by watching it. But what you are going to do is learn what's been happening in the customer experience world and maybe smile a couple of times.
In a recent episode, you made fun of Amazon's plan to, well, they have a patent for a blimp, right? And it's not really clear what they're going to do with this blimp, but someone released a fake video showing the blimp releasing all of these delivery drones. And what was the music that was laid over it?
Oh, it's the Star Wars, Imperial March one. Yeah.
Right.
Realistically, if they could make that work, if they could logistically make deliveries to customers a lot quicker and a lot more personalized by doing that, it's actually a really cool idea. Yeah, it's a little bit scary to have Amazon blimps flying around. We'll get used to it. We got used to plenty of things in the past. Cars were scary once, and people on horses were like, oh no, I don't. We'll get used to it. It's actually a good idea. The reason I made fun of it on the show is because, well, that's the format of the show. I can't just say, here's a thing that's happened. Kind of cool.
That you like or you agree with.
Yeah, I'll just make fun of anything and everything. I'm an equal opportunity fun maker of her.
Was this show inspired by any popular late night talk shows that you happen to watch? Because I sense undertones of John Oliver, minus the political commentary, like you said.
I tend not to get political. I mean, to be fair, some of the episodes have ended up with a little bit of a political edge. But at the end of the day, are we not all customers of the government or something? Kind of.
Any plans for the show coming up that we should know about?
Not really. I might do a live one at the end of the year, this year in CX. Sell tickets, make a bit of money. That'd be great. No, I'd probably just let people come for free. Record the audience. Laughter. Do you think that'd be neat?
That would be neat. Yeah.
Good.
You invite people to taping, you'd feel like you're James Corden or someone. Jimmy Kimmel. Yeah, you'd be up there.
Yeah.
Okay.
With less of a budget.
We're really excited to have you join us in Vegas this June for the 20th anniversary of Customer Contact Week. Give us a sneak peek of what you'll be discussing.
Yes. I'm going to be talking about first impressions because it's, I kind of have to, because it's like the start of my, it doesn't make sense otherwise. So I have to talk about that. I'm going to be talking about super fans, and I'm going to be talking about misunderstandings in CX.
Okay. Are we going to be hearing some funny song lyrics then?
We are. Indeed.
Okay. All right. We'll look out for you and your guitar then.
Nice.